Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Mussolini's War, Fascist Italy from Triumph to Collapse, 1935 to 1943, by John Gooch. Narrated by Bruce Mann. The character of a leader is a large factor in the game of war. General William Tecumseh Sherman. Dramatis Personae. Ambrosio, General Vittorio. Commissioned as a cavalry officer, Ambrosio served as a divisional staff officer during the First World War and a divisional and then corps commander in the years that followed. In 1939, he was given command of 2nd Army on the Yugoslav border, leading the Italian offensive against the Yugoslavs in April 1941. Exchanging posts with Mario Roata, he became Chief of the Army General Staff in January 1942. On the 1st of February 1943, Mussolini appointed him Chief of the Armed Forces General Staff. A dyed-in-the-wool monarchist, he played a major part in the plotting that led to Mussolini's downfall after repeated but fruitless attempts to persuade Mussolini to change course. On the 8th to the 9th of September, after the announcement of the armistice, he left Rome along with the king, Badoglio, and others, serving under the rump Italian government as Inspector General of the Army until November 1944. Armee, General Cesare. Armee joined the Italian Military Intelligence Service, Servizio Informazioni Militari, SIM, in 1921, serving first in the counter-espionage center at Turin and then in Vienna and Budapest. Leaving SIM in 1929, he held a command post in Perugia and then taught at the Air Force Academy at Caserta from 1933 to 1935. Promoted colonel in 1937, he commanded an infantry regiment and served first as a divisional and then as corps chief of staff. Recalled to SIM as vice chief with Mussolini's approval at the beginning of January 1940, he was appointed head of SIM on the 20th of September 1940. By the end of 1941, he commanded an organization of 1,500 officers, non-commissioned officers, and specialized troops, double the size of the one he took over. He was removed by Badoglio on the 18th of August, 1943. Armellini, General Quirino. A faithful follower of Badoglio, Armellini commanded an Eritrean battalion during the reconquest of Libya. In November 1935, Badoglio made him operations chief in Ethiopia. From 1936 until 1938, he served as military commander of the Amhara district. Following divisional commands in Italy, he served as Badoglio's chief staff officer at the Comando Supremo in June 1940 until he was replaced in January 1941 following his master's fall. He commanded the La Spezia infantry division and then the 18th Corps in Dalmatia and Croatia until he was replaced in July 1942, following a clash with the civil governor of Dalmatia, Giuseppe Bastianini. When Mussolini fell on the 25th of July 1943, Armellini was tasked by Badoglio with dissolving the fascist militia, Milizia Volontaria per la Sicurezza Nazionale, and incorporating it into the army. After the armistice, he joined the resistance in Rome, heading the clandestine military front there from March 1944. Badoglio, Marshal Pietro. Badoglio enjoyed a meteoric rise during the First World War, climbing from lieutenant colonel to lieutenant general in only 2 years. His 27th Corps front collapsed during the Battle of Caporetto, giving rise to accusations of failure and then of a cover-up which dogged him throughout his life, as they continue to do. After serving as ambassador to Brazil between 1923 and 1925, he became Army Chief of Staff and then Capo di Stato Maggiore Generale, Chief of the Armed Forces General Staff, from 1925 to 1940. Between 1929 and 1933, he was Governor of Libya, and then from November 1935 to May 1936, he directed the war in Ethiopia, all the while still holding his position in Rome. He both solicited and received rich rewards. The king made him Duke of Addis Ababa in July 1936. His direction of military affairs was generally unimpressive. Uncharacteristically, he openly criticized Mussolini after the Greek debacle in November 1940 and lost office as a result. His deep-seated dislike of the Germans was probably only exceeded by his visceral hatred of Cavallero, in whose death he may have had an indirect hand. Appointed head of the government on the 25th of July 1943, he fled Rome for Brindisi with the king and others on the 8th to 9th of September 1943, continuing to head the rump Italian government until June 1944. Balbo, Italo. Fascist Ras, party chief of Ferrara, and one of the four men appointed by Mussolini to lead the march on Rome in October 1922, Balbo became first undersecretary and then minister of aviation. Courageous, energetic, and charming, he made an international reputation by leading four long-distance training flights, including a double-crossing of the Atlantic. A good organizer, he was unable to overcome deep-seated inter-service rivalries or to impose a uniform doctrine on the Air Force. In January 1934, seeing him as a dangerous rival and potential successor, Mussolini exiled him to Libya as governor. In June 1940, his plane was misidentified as a British fighter shortly after an enemy attack and shot down over Tobruk by Italian anti-aircraft batteries. Balbo Drive, a street in Chicago where he was feted on reaching America, is still named after him. Bastico, General Ettore. Bastico's 53-year military career began, like many others, with the Italo-Turkish War in Libya. After distinguished service during the First World War, he rose through the ranks during the interwar years, establishing a reputation as something of a thinking general with his book The Evolution of the Art of War, in which he took on Giulio Douay, who he thought had overemphasized the mechanized aspect of war at the cost of the human element. He also developed a close friendship with Mussolini. During the Abyssinian War, he commanded the 1st Black Shirt / 23 Marzo Division, and in 1937 he briefly led the Corpo di Truppe Volontarie, CTV, in the Spanish Civil War. In December 1940, he was appointed military governor of the Dodecanese, and on the 19th of July 1941, Mussolini made him governor of Libya and nominal commander of the Axis forces in North Africa. Rommel, who clashed frequently with him over his logistical and strategic caution, nicknamed him Bombastico. Promoted Maresciallo d'Italia, Marshal of Italy, on the 12th of August 1942, so as not to be junior to Rommel, he was relieved in February 1943 after Tripoli fell. Campioni, Admiral Inigo. Widely regarded during the latter years of his peacetime career as the most promising officer in the Regia Marina, Campioni served on battleships and then commanded convoys during the First World War. His interwar career, during which he rose to flag rank in 1932, included time as naval attaché in Paris, command of the battleship Duilio and a heavy cruiser, and service as Admiral Cavagnari's office chief. In 1938, he was made deputy chief of the naval staff, and in 1939, he was appointed to command the 1st Naval Squadron, the main Italian battle fleet. criticized after the battles of Punta Stilo and Capo Teulada in July and November 1940 for being overcautious and failing to press home his advantage, he was replaced on the 8th of December 1940. He returned to the post of Deputy Chief of the Naval Staff, and then in October 1941 became Governor of the Dodecanese, surrendering them to the Germans on the 11th of September 1943, 3 days after the armistice. Imprisoned by the Germans, he was handed over in January 1944 to Mussolini's Italian Social Republic, Repubblica Sociale Italiana, RSI, which convicted him of high treason after he repeatedly refused to collaborate with it. Offered a pardon if he recognized the RSI as Italy's legitimate government, he rejected it outright and was shot in the city square of Parma. In November 1947, he was posthumously awarded Italy's highest decoration for valor, the Medaglia d'Oro. Cavagnari, Admiral Domenico. During the First World War, Cavagnari commanded a squadron of destroyer leaders, Esploratori. From 1929 to 1932, he was head of the Italian Naval Academy at Livorno. His time there coincided with a change of tone in the Navy's relationship with the regime and an increased emphasis on the positive virtues of fascism. As Undersecretary of the Navy from November 1933 and Chief of the Naval Staff from June 1934, Cavagnari shaped the Navy that went to war in 1940, keeping a tight hold on everything and insisting on uniformity and obedience. A battleship admiral, he showed little interest in aircraft carriers, like his master, or in radar, effectively closing down research and innovation in January 1934 with the declaration that, at sea, a simple device, resistant and which functions reliably, is preferable to another which, though more sophisticated and faster, is more complex, fragile and less reliable. He did, though, oversee the construction of 60 submarines intended to attrite enemy battleships and carriers between 1935 and 1940. The indecisive battle of Punta Stilo and the successful enemy strike at Taranto in November 1940 ended his career. Cavallero, Marshal Ugo. During the First World War, Cavallero, who was popular with the rank and file there for his easygoing attitude, served first on Cadorna's headquarters and then as operations chief under Badoglio, deputy chief of staff to Cadorna's successor, Marshal Diaz. In 1920, sensing that peacetime promotion would be slow, he left the army for private industry. In 1925, Mussolini made him Undersecretary of State for War, a position he held for 3 years, during which time he and Badoglio became bitter rivals, and from which he was removed after direct intervention from the king. He then worked for 5 years for Ansaldo, as a result of which he was suspected for the rest of his life of profiteering from the firm's supply of poor-quality steel for the armed forces. After a period commanding the troops in Italian East Africa, he was sacked by the viceroy, Amedeo Duke of Aosta. In June 1939, Mussolini sent him to Berlin to handle the negotiations that followed the signing of the Pact of Steel on the 22nd of May. On the 6th of December 1940, he succeeded Badoglio as Chief of the Armed Forces General Staff, and was immediately sent to Albania to take over the conduct of the Greek War from Ubaldo Sodu, returning to Rome in May 1941. Somewhat too accommodating to the Germans for some of his fellow generals, Cavallero held office until the 31st of January 1943, chiefly perhaps because, unlike his successor Ambrosio, he never questioned the Duce's direction of the war. In July 1943, Badoglio had him arrested, and then, when he was released after the king's intervention, had him arrested again. During his imprisonment, he wrote a memorandum in which he claimed to have conspired against Mussolini from November 1942. When Badoglio fled Rome, he left the Memoriale Cavallero on his desk. The Germans found it. With this in his hands, Kesselring offered Cavallero command of the armed forces of what would become the RSI. On the 13th of September 1943, Cavallero had supper with Kesselring. Next morning, he was found dead in the garden of the hotel in Frascati in which he was staying, having apparently committed suicide. Some suspect that he was murdered. Ciano, Count Galeazzo. The son of an admiral and a minister in Mussolini's cabinet who was close to the Duce, Ciano married Mussolini's daughter Edda in April 1930. His rise thereafter was rapid. Undersecretary and then Minister for Propaganda, he was promoted Foreign Minister by his father-in-law on the 9th of June 1936, a post he held until February 1943 when he was demoted to Ambassador to the Holy See. Vulgar, ambitious, and opportunistic, Ciano was at first little more than a placeman. Mounting anxiety about Italy's vulnerability to a dominating Nazi Germany changed that, and led ultimately to Ciano's voting for his father-in-law's dismissal at the meeting of the Fascist Council on the 24th to the 25th of July 1943. That cost him his life. After foolishly fleeing to Germany, he was handed over to the RSI, tried and convicted as a traitor, and shot in the back. For anyone so minded, a video of his execution can be found on YouTube. Fava Grossa, General Carlo. An engineer, Fava Grossa served as a junior officer in the Libyan War and the First World War. After presiding over the control commission for the observation of the armistice in Vienna in 1919, he served in Cyrenaica and then on military and diplomatic duties in France and Czechoslovakia. Following regimental command and then service as deputy commandant of the Artillery and Engineers Academy, he was given command of Italy's lone motor mechanized brigade in June 1936. Sent to Spain in the aftermath of Guadalajara, he completely reorganized the Intendance Supply Service. After divisional commands, he took over the presidency of the General Commissariat for War Production, Commissariato Generale per le Fabbricazioni di Guerra, COGEFAG, on the 1st of September 1939. On the 23rd of May 1940, he was renamed an Undersecretary of State for War Production, and on the 6th of February 1943, raised to the rank of Minister. In office, he controlled the allocation of raw materials, though always having to contest this with various branches of the Fascist Party, but not weapons procurement. Forgier, General Rino Corso. Forgier began war service in 1915 with the Bersaglieri, light infantry, but transferred to the air wing in 1916, winning 3 silver medals for valour. After the war, as successively a squadron, wing and group commander, he impressed the air minister, Italo Balbo, who, when governor of Libya, called him to Tripolitania between 1935 and 1937. Put in command of the Prima Squadra Aerea in May 1940, he commanded the Air Expeditionary Force, Corpo Aereo Italiano, in Belgium, which joined in the bombardment of Great Britain between the 10th of September 1940 and the 28th of January 1941. On the 15th of November 1941, he succeeded Pricolo as Undersecretary of State for Air and Chief of the Air Staff. He was removed from office on the 27th of July, 1943. Gambara, General Gastone. Gambara began his military career as a non-commissioned officer before graduating from the Modena Military Academy via a special course for promising NCOs. During the First World War, he served in the Alpini Specialized Mountain Troops, winning 2 Medaglia d'Argento silver medals, Italy's second highest award for gallantry, in 9 months in 1918. After commanding an Alpini battalion in the early 1920s, he held a variety of staff posts. He fought in Ethiopia and then in Spain, where he was chief of staff to the CTV. After commanding the 15th Corps in the brief battle in the French Alps in June 1940, he next commanded the 8th Corps in the war against Greece from the 5th of February 1941. On the 11th of May 1941, he was transferred to Tripoli, first as Garibaldi's and then Bastico's chief of staff, and then as commander first of the Corpo d'Armata Corazzato, Armored Corps, and subsequently the Corpo d'Armata di Manovra, Maneuver Corps. After falling out with Rommel and Cavallero, he was recalled on the 6th of March 1942 and sent to Slovenia in September to command the 11th Corps, staying there until the 5th of September 1943. After the armistice, Gambara sided with the fascist Repubblica Sociale Italiana, and on the 20th of October 1943, he was appointed chief of staff of the Republican National Army. Mussolini removed him on the 12th of March 1944 for excessive pessimism. His name was on the 1947 Anglo-American list of war criminals, but, like others, he escaped arraignment either in Italy or abroad. Garibaldi, General Italo. Garibaldi served in staff posts during the First World War. Between 1920 and 1925, he led the Italian delegation determining the Yugoslav frontier. Regimental and brigade command was followed by command of the military academy at Modena and the school of application at Parma. In 1936, he commanded the Sabauda division on the march on Addis Ababa. As chief of staff to the governor of Italian East Africa, he participated in the brutal repression of Abyssinian resistance. Recalled in February 1938, he commanded an army corps and then, from the 11th of June 1940 to the 11th of February 1941, the 5th Army in Tripolitania, at which time he took over from Graziani as commander-in-chief and governor-general. Tense relations with Rommel, of whose lightning reconquest of Cyrenaica he disapproved, led to his recall on the 19th of July 1941. In spring 1942, he was appointed to command the 8th Army, Armia, in Russia. Garibaldi was at Parma rebuilding the shattered 8th Army when, on the 15th of September 1943, he was arrested by the Germans. Refusing to collaborate with them, he was first interned in Germany and then handed over to the RSI, which condemned him to 10 years' imprisonment. Geloso, General Carlo. An artilleryman, Geloso won 3 silver medals for valor during the First World War. Emerging from it as a colonel, he went into the Special Reserve until recalled with the advent of fascism. After regimental command and staff service, he fought in Somalia in 1936 and then participated in the pacification of Ethiopia, using methods which even Roberto Farinacci, a hardline fascist, judged often disproportionate and unjustified. In December 1939, he commanded the 26th Corps in Albania, succeeding Guzzoni, but was replaced in the summer of 1940 by Visconti Prasca at Ciano's behest. Recalled to Albania in November 1940, he commanded the 11th Army until April 1941. He then served as military governor of Greece until unseated by a scandal in May 1943, after which his pleading letters to Mussolini were studiously ignored. Following the armistice in September 1943, he was captured and interned by the Germans at Poznan until freed by the Red Army. The Ethiopian government tried unsuccessfully to extradite him for war crimes in 1947, a year after the Greek government, then in the midst of a civil war, announced that it did not intend to pursue the extradition of any Italians held to have carried out illegal actions in their country. Graziani, Marshal Rodolfo. After gaining his university matriculation, Graziani enrolled for a 2-year course in law, but never completed his studies. Too poor to attend one of the military academies, he was conscripted into the army, serving as a non-commissioned officer and then as a second lieutenant, before winning a permanent commission in 1906. In Libya throughout the First World War, he emerged from it the youngest colonel in the army and one of the most decorated. After briefly abandoning the army but failing to make his way in the civilian world, he returned to Libya in 1921 and stayed for 13 years, taking a leading part in the repression and reconquest of the colony and carving a reputation for himself as one of Italy's most aggressive and successful soldiers. Promoted to Generale di Corpo d'Armata, Lieutenant General, he was recalled to Rome in 1934, but left again in February 1935 to take command of Italian forces in Somalia. His success there earned him the baton of Maresciallo d'Italia. As Viceroy of Ethiopia, he hanged and shot rebel leaders, becoming markedly more ruthless after an attempt on his life on the 19th of February 1937. Returning to Rome in January 1938, Graziani was appointed Chief of the Army General Staff on the 1st of November 1939, apparently learning of his appointment on the 1 o'clock news, and then, in June 1940, Governor of Libya. He was relieved of command on the 8th of February 1941 and was not employed again until Mussolini made him War Minister of the RSI in late 1943. On the partisans list for execution, Graziani escaped retribution when he fell into American hands. First an Allied prisoner of war and then imprisoned in Italy, he was tried in May 1950 for military collaboration with Germany, and condemned to 19 years incarceration, but released 4 months later. The Abyssinian government's attempt to extradite him and try him for war crimes came to naught. Guzzoni, General Alfredo. Guzzoni served as a frontline staff officer for most of the First World War, during which he won 2 Medaglia d'Argento, and afterwards on the Inter-Allied Control Commissions for Austria and Hungary. Regimental, brigade and divisional commands followed. In November 1935, he was sent to Eritrea, where he stayed as governor from June 1936 to April 1937. After leading the forces that invaded Albania on the 7th to 8th of April 1939, he commanded the 4th Army during the brief campaign against France in June 1940. On the 30th of November 1940, he was nominated Under Secretary of State for War and Deputy Chief of the Armed Forces General Staff, a job he seems to have done fairly well. Cavallero abolished his deputy's post on his return to Rome after the Greek War ended, and forced Guzzoni to resign as Under-Secretary in May 1941. On the 1st of June 1943, Guzzoni was given command of the 6th Army and made responsible for the defence of Sicily, a difficult role in which he failed to shine. He was imprisoned by the RSI on the 26th of October 1943, following an attack on his record in Sicily by Roberto Farinacci, but released 2 weeks later after pressure from the German High Command. Iachino, Admiral Angelo. Iachino spent the early part of the First World War on board the battleship Giulio Cesare, before commanding a torpedo boat in the Adriatic and winning a Medaglia d'Argento silver medal. After serving as naval attaché in China between 1923 and 1928, he commanded a destroyer, a light cruiser, and then two groups of light ships during the Spanish Civil War. In August 1940, he was given command of the 2nd Naval Squadron. He took part in the Battle of Cape Spartivento in November 1940 and replaced Campioni as commander of the battle fleet the following month. Much criticized for his handling of the Battle of Cape Matapan, during which he lost an entire cruiser division, he survived until the 5th of April 1943 and was then replaced by Admiral Carlo Bergamini. He was restored to active service in 1948 and finally discharged in 1962. Maras, General Ephesio. An artilleryman, Maras was selected as Italy's military attaché in Berlin in October 1936. He stayed in post for 7 years, apart from a short interlude in the summer of 1939, when he was replaced by General Mario Roatta. Acting as the Commando Supremo's eyes and ears there, he reported and interpreted Nazi military policy. After the armistice, he was interned by the Germans and then handed over to the RSI and imprisoned. In August 1944, he escaped and reached Switzerland. After the war, he served first as Army Chief of Staff and then from 1950 to 1954 as Chief of the Defence Staff, playing a major role in the reconstruction of the Italian Army. Messe, Marshal Giovanni. Italy's finest general, Messe took a major part in training and then leading elite RDT infantry units during the latter years of the First World War, winning a Medaglia d'Argento. After service as a Royal aide-de-camp between 1923 and 1927, he commanded a Bersaglieri unit and then a motorized brigade, which he led during the war in Ethiopia and from which he emerged as a major general. Deputy commander during the invasion of Albania in April 1939, he then commanded the Celere Rapid Corps between June and December 1940. His success during the Greek War, in which he commanded the Corpo d'Armata Speciale, Special Army Corps, led to his being appointed to command the Corpo di Spedizione Italiano in Russia, CSIR, in July 1941, when the first choice fell ill. After failing to persuade Cavallero and Mussolini not to expand the CSIR to full army size, rubbing up against the Germans and disagreeing with the new 8th Army commander, Garibaldi, over strategy, Messe asked to be relieved and left Russia in November 1942. In February 1943, Mussolini handed him a poisoned chalice, appointing him to command Italian forces in Tunisia. After the surrender of Axis forces in North Africa in May 1943, he was confined, along with other senior captives, in England, his conversations bugged by his captors. In September 1943, he was made Chief of Staff of the Italian co-belligerent army, a post he held until the end of the war. Pirzio Biroli, General Alessandro. The son of one of Garibaldi's volunteers, Pirzio Biroli was commissioned into the Bersaglieri. During the First World War, he first served on the staff in Rome and then as a staff officer in Macedonia before transferring to the Italian front after Caporetto. Between 1922 and 1927, he headed a military mission to Ecuador, following this with divisional and corps command. He commanded the Eritrean Corps during the Abyssinian War, and then, as a full general, held office as governor of Amhara. After attempting and failing to crush the revolt which broke out there in August 1937, for which Graziani held him responsible, he was dismissed in December 1937. Unemployed until February 1941, he was then made commander of the 9th Army in Albania. As governor and military commander in Montenegro from October 1941, he used the ruthless methods practiced in Abyssinia to hold down his fiefdom. In June 1943, the Commando Supremo created Army Group East, leaving Pirzio Biroli with only civil powers. He returned to Rome the following month. Following the armistice, he was offered the post of Minister of National Defense by Mussolini, but declined it. Passing through the German lines, he escaped to Brindisi, and in October 1944, he was recalled to temporary service to head a commission examining awards for valor. On the Allied list of war criminals, he too escaped retribution. Reportedly a crack shot with a pistol, Pirzio Biroli won a silver medal in the Team Sabre event at the 1908 London Olympics. Pricolo, General Francesco. Commissioned as an engineer, Pricolo flew dirigibles in the Italo-Turkish War and then in the First World War, winning two silver medals for valor. After filling a variety of command and staff posts, including Deputy Chief of the Air Staff for 10 months in 1932 to 1933, he was appointed Under Secretary of State for Air and Chief of the Air Staff on the 10th of November 1939. Used by Mussolini as a personal channel of information on the mishandling of the early stages of the Greek War, he had disagreements with Cavallero and was distrusted by Rommel, who accused him of fickleness. He was fired on the 14th of November 1941 after failing to send the new Marquis 202 fighters to North Africa as ordered, on the grounds that the personnel to fly them were not yet trained and the planes lacked sand filters. He was put on permanent leave in August 1945 and finally retired in 1954. Riccardi, Admiral Arturo. Riccardi began his career serving with the Italian Marines in the Boxer Rebellion and then in the Far East Campaign of 1905. Following war service, he held several important staff posts in the main office of the Navy Ministry, becoming Director General of Personnel and Military Services in August 1935, 3 years after he made Admiral and 1 year after he joined the La Spezia branch of the Fascist Party. On the 8th of December 1940, he succeeded Cavagnari as Undersecretary of the Navy and Chief of the Naval Staff. He was removed from both offices by Badoglio on the 27th of July 1943, following Mussolini's downfall. Roatta, General Mario. A highly intelligent, equally controversial and somewhat elusive figure, Roatta served in Italy and France during the First World War and then as military attaché in Warsaw between 1924 and 1930. In 1934, he was chosen to head the Servizio Informazioni Militari, Italian Military Intelligence, SIM. Likely involved in the assassination of King Alexander of Yugoslavia in October 1934, and shadowed thereafter by French intelligence during his visits to France, he planned in January 1936 to kidnap or assassinate Haile Selassie, but was prevented from doing so by Mussolini. As the first commander of the CTV in the Spanish Civil War, he failed to distinguish himself, losing the Battle of Guadalajara. After acting as military attaché in Berlin between August and October 1939, he served first as Graziani's deputy chief of army staff from the 31st of October 1939, and then as chief of army staff until the 20th of January 1942, when he took over command of the occupation forces in Slovenia and Dalmatia. He left the Balkans in February 1943 and, after briefly being responsible for the defense of Sicily, became Chief of Army Staff for the second time in June 1943, fleeing Rome with Badoglio in September. He was sacked by Badoglio on the 12th of November 1943 on Allied insistence after being charged by the Yugoslavs with war crimes. In circumstances that are still unexplained, he escaped from a prison hospital in Rome on the 5th of March 1945 and took refuge in Spain, where he stayed until 1966. In Italy, he was sentenced in absentia to life imprisonment and a year's solitary confinement, a sentence that was overturned by the High Court of Appeal in 1948. Allied opinions of him varied from the uncomplimentary to the unprintable. Sodu, General Ubaldo. Sodu spent most of the First World War in Cyrenaica, returning in May 1918 and serving in France, where he won a Medaglia d'Argento, a Croix de Guerre, and the Légion d'Honneur. Much of his interwar career, during which he took a law degree, was spent teaching at various military institutions and publishing military studies. He caught the Duce's eye first as head of the War Minister's Office between 1934 and 1936 for his skill in shaping military legislation, and then as author of a book proclaiming the virtues of rapid, decisive war. In December 1937, he was made Deputy Chief of Army Staff for Operations, and in October 1939, Under Secretary of State for War, a post he held until the 30th of November 1940. On the 8th of November 1940, promoted full general, he was given command of the war against Greece, a position he held for only 52 days before being replaced first unofficially and then officially by Cavallero. Placed in reserve thereafter, he was arrested twice and imprisoned once following the fall of Mussolini on the 25th of July 1943 and freed by the Germans on the 12th of September 1943. He spent the rest of his life in retirement. Visconti Prasca, General Sebastiano. After service during the First World War, Visconti Prasca served as military and air attaché in Belgrade between 1925 and 1930, before commanding the Italian Corps in the Saar in 1934. He served as military attaché in Paris from 1937 to 1939. A proponent of the new style fascist lightning war, as commander of the Italian forces invading Greece, he failed dismally and was replaced by Ubaldo Sodu after only 2 weeks. He was immediately retired. In September 1943, he joined the resistance movement. Captured by the Germans and sentenced to death, subsequently commuted to life imprisonment, he escaped and reportedly fought with the Red Army, taking part in the Battle of Berlin. Introduction. When, on the 30th of October 1922, Mussolini took charge of Italy and inducted the country into fascism, a revolution that he would begin to try to enforce 3 years later after defeating the radical wing of his own party, his intention was to forge a new, resurgent state and force the international community to recognize that his fiefdom was no longer the least of the great powers. Carving out a new Roman Empire that would cover the Mediterranean and North Africa, include a substantial slice of the Balkans, and open gateways onto the Atlantic and the Indian Ocean, would give fascist Italy its rightful place in world affairs. Parts of this agenda were not new. Liberal Italy had unveiled its colonial ambitions when it set foot in Massawa on the Red Sea in 1885, and again when it fought the Turks in Libya in 1911 to 1912 and won possession of a new colony. Nor were Italian ambitions in the Balkans, and even briefly in Anatolian Turkey, signs of a new appetite for expansion. The continuities between the foreign policies of liberal and fascist Italy have given historians plenty of ammunition for debate and disagreement. What was new was the interlocking of these goals into a composite program, and the ambitious drive that Mussolini gave to achieving them. To conquer what he and many in his entourage regarded as Italy's spazio vitale, living space, meant dealing both with legacies from the past and the contextual circumstances of the present. For a while, Mussolini seemed to succeed on both fronts. Before the First World War, Italian diplomats had worked pragmatically, avoiding antagonizing the great powers, seeking openings to advance where there was no powerful resistance, and using force when it looked as though they could do so without causing a hostile international reaction. One consequence of this was that on the eve of the World War, Italy's military record was mixed at best. Allowed by the great powers to establish a foothold in Eritrea, and encouraged by their politicians, Italian soldiers had pushed inland, challenging the independent warrior empire of Ethiopia. Reach was not matched by grasp, and Italian arms suffered a total and humiliating defeat at the Battle of Vardua on the 1st of March 1896. This put a stop to Italian initiatives in the region. Mussolini would breathe new life to them in 1935. This confirmed the low opinion that many Italian politicians, notably the pre-war premier Giovanni Giolitti, had of Italian military capacity. His army won Libya for him in the Italo-Turkish War, but it was only partially a victory. The troops on the ground suffered some serious setbacks. The Turks only backed out of this war when they faced another in the Balkans, and thereafter, Istanbul backed an ongoing guerrilla war in Libya, which lasted throughout the World War that followed, during which Italians were able to keep only four coastal footholds. In both colonial wars, Italian armies used brutal methods against the local populations. If the record of the peacetime liberal administrations appeared to leave a lot to be desired and much to improve upon, so did Italy's performance during the First World War. Coming late into the war, she joined in on the Entente's side in May 1915 after extensive parleying with both parties, and her international disapprobation, which only increased with time. Her entry into the war also deepened pre-existing fault lines in society, with right-wing and conservative interventionists ranged against left-wing and democratic neutralists. Though, confusingly, Democrats could also back the war in support of Belgium, while the official Socialist Party stood somewhere in the middle, neither for the war nor against it. For 3 years, the Italian and Austro-Hungarian armies grappled with one another in the mountains and limestone uplands along their common border. It was, as an on-the-spot British observer remarked, a desperate country to fight in. Then, on the 24th of October 1917, Italy suffered an almost catastrophic defeat when German and Austro-Hungarian forces broke Marshal Cadorna's army at Caporetto and pursued it as far as the Piave River. There the army held before the Anglo-French forces that were coming to its support had got into position to lend a hand, and began first a recovery and then a fight back that ended in October 1918, when it in turn broke the Austro-Hungarians at the Battle of Vittorio Veneto. The Battle of Caporetto has become part of the everyday Italian lexicon. When Ferrari were beaten in the Japanese Grand Prix, Italian sports papers talked of a Singaporetto. The First World War cost Italy some 650,000 dead. If this casualty list more or less matched that of Great Britain, who lost 750,000 men and fought for 9 months more, a macabre form of calculation and not in itself of great value, it did not earn Italy much in the way of international acknowledgement or recognition. In the aftermath, both Georges Clemenceau and David Lloyd George denigrated Italy's military record, the Welshman declaring that when compared with his own countrymen, the Italians had no idea what fighting meant. At the Paris Peace Conference in 1919, Italy's territorial claims were made to look grasping and cynical, which by no means all of them were. In Italy, Mussolini poured criticism on the government in the pages of his newspaper, Il Popolo d'Italia. By making only vague and high-sounding public declarations, but failing to equalize the burdens paid by town and country in terms of both blood and money, it had failed, both morally and economically. How Italy had come to lose the 12th Battle of the Isonzo, i.e. Caporetto, was something of a mystery. But as a frontline soldier himself, Mussolini was certainly not inclined to blame the ordinary fante infantryman, despite Cadorna's talk of deficient resistance by some detachments. The future, Mussolini declared, would now be in the hands not of the old elites, civilian or military, but of the trenchocracy, which, come peacetime, would unite class and nation. The First World War would have dramatic consequences for Italian politics. No less important, though much less obvious at the time, were the strategic lessons it offered, and those it did not. Before the war, soldiers and politicians had agreed that Italy was strategically vulnerable. Her lengthy coastline and her islands were wide open to attack, and the mountains along which her northern borders ran to penetration. With the two major naval powers in the Mediterranean, Great Britain and France, on her side, her vulnerability to enemy sea power was never really exposed. Wartime Italy faced only minor naval threats from Austro-Hungarian and German units in Pola and Trieste, and by the war's end had support in the shape of British, American, Australian and Japanese naval vessels, and a mass of nets and mines closing the neck of the Adriatic. So, with no great sea battles in prospect, the major task the Italian navy faced was shepherding convoys across the Mediterranean alongside her Entente allies. Coal, food and weapons from her Western partners, not least the United States, flowed along the arteries formed by well-defended sea lanes. None of this would Italy enjoy when Mussolini took her into another war. When compared with the war fought by the powers that would, in 1940 and 1941, become her enemies, the land war that the Italian armies fought between 1915 and 1918 was characterized by particular local conditions and circumstances which would not be repeated. The stage was smaller and the cast of combatants limited, though the action was just as bloody. With France on her side and Switzerland neutral, the fighting front was, relatively speaking, small, clearly defined, and unambiguous. There were sideshows, to be sure. Italian units fought in Greece and were present, albeit in very small numbers, with General Edmund Allenby in Palestine. But in strategic terms, this was essentially a single theater war. It was also a static war. For most of the time, the Italian armies were nailed to the mountains. There, they fought their enemy at close range, relying on infantry assaults backed by artillery, of which they never had enough. No mechanized warfare here, and no mobile warfare to speak of either. Nor did the Italian armies have much experience of fighting alongside allies. 8 British and French divisions were entrained for Italy after Caporetto, but then 5 of them were hastily withdrawn again when the Germans launched their March offensive in 1918. Thus, much of the lesson learning which took place at the time and subsequently in the British, French and German armies had to be done by Italy at second hand. Under fascism, all 3 services had to prepare themselves for modern war. Exactly what war, in what circumstances, would depend entirely on how the Duce read the international situation. An element of continuity with the past here. All would be expected to be ready to shoulder whatever burdens came their way. All would be under pressure, but the army was under a particularly strong spotlight. Mussolini required his soldiers to shake off a legacy of defeats and partial victories, which went back past Caporetto and Ardua to the wars of the Risorgimento and beyond, and give lie to the old calumny that Italiani sunt imbelles, The Italians can't fight. Joining in a second major war, at first European and then global, would entail grasping, assessing, and then mastering complex strategic challenges. Neutrality was one such challenge. In the First World War, it had simplified Italy's fight. Now a neutral Spain at one end of the Mediterranean and a neutral Turkey at the other would act as geopolitical bookends, which Mussolini could do nothing about and which would ultimately play to Allied advantage. Theatre warfare was another. The army, navy and air force had to win their campaigns if Italy was to be victorious, but they had to be the right campaigns, fought, if possible, at the right time and in the right place. In 1940, the strategic checkerboard was not yet as complex as it would become the following year. There are lost opportunities for every combatant in every war, and one will be able to judge for oneself how much Mussolini's obdurate refusal to accept German assistance in North Africa in the autumn and winter of 1940 to 1941, when the Wehrmacht was between campaigns of its own, cost him. Then there is resource allocation. Parceling out men, guns, planes, and ships to meet competing demands in ever more widely divergent theatres would be an increasingly demanding task for a combatant that was still the least of the great powers. Mussolini's military chiefs would spend increasing amounts of time and energy on a problem they were unable to resolve. The Second World War was the supreme test for every combatant. Fascist Italy, 18 years in the making when that test came in May 1940, was no exception. How did warlord Mussolini and the armed forces that served him fare in meeting the challenges that he and they faced between 1940 and 1943? The balance sheet is set out in the story that follows. Chapter 1. On the March. For Italy, the first post-war years were difficult ones. Demobilization was slow. At the end of 1919, there were still 500,000 men in the army, and the process only came to an end in 1921. There was mounting internal disorder as Italian labor joined an international general strike in June 1919, and two violent years of internal strife began. And to many who had worn or were still wearing a uniform, the peace settlement and the mutilated victory that the politicians brought back from Versailles confirmed the feeling that the fighting had all been for nothing. "No march on Vienna," a disenchanted RDT captain moaned in July 1919. "No affirmation of victory. No colonies, no fiume, no indemnity, nothing of any merit." Economies hit the army hard. All promotions were suspended for 5 years. Several thousand, mostly junior officers, were retired, and officers' pay was cut. Benito Mussolini's assurance that officers would get a decent salary, made some 6 months before the march on Rome that brought him to power in October 1922, was welcome. Some of fascism's goals dovetailed with those nursed by the soldiers, so the army happily collaborated with the fascist blackshirts in restoring order after the occupation of the factories and the wave of civil strikes in 1920. It also found fascism's expansionist agenda very much to its taste. Against that, the early fascist party looked rather too republican. In August 1922, a group of officers warned it not to set itself against the crown. They got only an ambiguous reply. For 6 years between 1919 and 1925, while Mussolini first took power and then consolidated his hold on it by shedding the radical aspects of fascism, the generals argued with one another and the politicians over how many men were to be conscripted into the army each year, how long they were to serve in it, and how large it ought to be. Finally, in April 1925, Mussolini took over the reins of the War Ministry himself, holding them until September 1929 and settled the question. A force of 250,000, mostly conscripts serving 18 months, would form 30 triangular divisions, each made up of 9 battalions. Numbers would vary, rebalancing the force over the year in order to keep within the budget. The measure was one of a raft of 7 laws intended to create the institutions that would shape the nation's defences in peace and in war. They included the creation of a Supreme Defence Commission to determine in peacetime what the army would need in war, and the position of Chief of the Armed Forces General Staff, whose occupant would be the technical consultant to the head of government for matters to do with the coordination of the defensive arrangements of the state and planning for future operations of war. The new post was given to General Pietro Badoglio, a conservative Piedmontese professional with a good, though not unblemished, wartime record. Some thought him at fault for the collapse at Caporetto on the 24th of October 1917. His appointment reassured the king, pleased the army, and went down well with the public. For 2 years he held the new post together with the position of Chief of the Army General Staff. Then Mussolini split the two offices apart and watered down Badoglio's powers. During the latter half of the 1920s, the soldiers rebuilt an army that looked very much like the one that had gone to war in 1915. The Stokes mortars, rifle grenades, flamethrowers, and semi-automatic weapons that had given small units the heavy firepower they needed in 1918 were discarded, and the army went back to old-fashioned rifle companies. Artillery lagged badly. Well into the 1930s, pre-war guns were being improved by lengthening their barrels and supplying them with better ammunition. Some of the best guns at the army's disposal were Škoda 75mm and 100mm howitzers captured from the Austrians. As the decade went on, the authorities put increased emphasis on physical training, and the concepts guiding the army in war began to take on a distinctly 19th century look. Combat regulations envisaged offensives in which artillery barrages would prepare the way for the infantry battalions to strike their blows, and stated flatly that the basis of any maneuver on the battlefield was the principle of mass. They acknowledged the importance of air-ground cooperation in reconnaissance and tactical strikes, but said little about tanks, mainly because everything was tailored to mountain warfare on the assumption that a new war would share the characteristics of the old, with Germany and Austria the likely enemies. In 1930, regulations made technology a second-order issue, declaring that war was, in its essence, the struggle of spirit and will. This was something on which the new generation of fascistized generals would build in the 1930s. In 1921, the liberal government decided that Italy must win back possession of Libya, taken from the Turks in the War of 1911 to 1912 and mostly lost during the World War. The reconquest began the following year. First, the army began to spread its reach along the coast of Tripolitania and penetrate inland, using coordinated columns of Eritrean battalions and local levies and inflicting harsh punishment on the rebels. It was now that Colonel, later Marshal, Rodolfo Graziani began to make his name as an expert leader of these light mobile forces. By the end of 1925, Graziani and his fellows had reconquered northern Tripolitania, killing some 6,500 Arabs at a cost of 2,582 Italians dead, wounded and missing. In Cyrenaica, General Ernesto Mombelli carried out sweeps using columns coordinated by wireless and supported by air to hunt down the Senussi tribesmen led by Omar El Mukhtar, destroying encampments and tents, seizing sheep and camels, and killing 400 rebels at a cost of 6 dead and 25 wounded. In July 1925, Mussolini decided that it was time for a new man to take over and appointed 59-year-old General Emilio De Bono as governor of Libya. While Graziani pushed into the interior of Tripolitania, using nomadic tribesmen and forging links with tribal leaders, De Bono sentenced rebels to death without a qualm and approved the use of phosgene gas on at least 4 occasions. Thanks partly to the effective use of aircraft in carrying out long-range and tactical reconnaissance, transporting troops and materiel, and coordinating the movement of columns, hunting down and killing rebel bands produced results. Graziani was particularly good at it. But clearing and controlling the vast desert hinterland was another matter. Also, subduing the Senussi needed a higher level of direction and order than De Bono was able to provide. So in December 1928, Mussolini replaced him with Badoglio. Over the next 3 years, Badoglio and Graziani set about breaking down Libya's entire socio-political order, confiscating Senussi property, disarming the tribes that submitted, and carrying out a series of public trials and executions. To separate the armed Senussi in Cyrenaica from the tribes who directly or indirectly supported them, they set up barbed wire enclosures on the coastal strip, and by the end of 1930, 80,000 tribespeople were confined in them. The internment camps made their contribution to the final death toll in Cyrenaica, which probably amounted to between 50,000 and 60,000 people. At Graziani's suggestion, a 270-kilometer-long barbed wire barrier was put up along the Egyptian border. Penned inside it and hunted down, Omar el-Mukhtar was captured on the 11th of September 1931 and hanged 5 days later in front of a crowd of 20,000 Arabs. On the 24th of January 1932, Badoglio announced that the rebellion in Cyrenaica had been defeated. Rome was triumphant. Libya was now entirely in Italian hands for the first time in almost 2 decades. The fascist armed forces had won their first campaign, Badoglio had polished his credentials as Fascist Italy's leading soldier, and the new Italy had shown itself to be efficient, effective, and merciless towards its enemies. Exactly what Mussolini wanted the world to see. War in Abyssinia. The road to Mussolini's first major war opened in July 1925. When his colonial minister, Pietro Lanza di Scalea, proposed reinforcing the Italian colonies of Eritrea and Somalia and blocking any movement of arms to Addis Ababa and to the Abyssinian Ras, tribal chiefs. The Duce was ready to begin positioning fascist Italy for expansion and conquest. At some time in the future, the Ethiopian Empire might collapse, and Italy must prepare herself militarily and diplomatically, working as far as possible in collaboration with the English and chloroforming the official Abyssinia world in the meantime. At first, things moved slowly. In June 1926, Mussolini agreed that Badoglio send a personal representative to assess the military conditions of Eritrea in view of a possible future conflict. General Giuseppe Malardra duly told Rome what it wanted to hear, that peace was precarious and war with a belligerent Abyssinia could break out at any moment. At the time and since, Italians have used the terms Ethiopia and Abyssinia interchangeably, with a preference for the former. To be able to defend itself, the colony needed 160,000 white troops on top of the 30 to 40,000 Eritreans available. Badoglio thought 40 to 50,000 Italian troops and a strong air force would be enough. For the moment, though, Italian policy still concentrated on chloroforming the Abyssinians. Local representatives negotiated a treaty of friendship and good neighborliness, and a convention on road building was signed on the 2nd of August 1928. When Ras Tafari became emperor 2 months later, relations worsened over the road contract and over Rome's refusal over the new emperor's request for aircraft. On the ground, a new governor of Eritrea, Corrado Zolli, attacked his predecessor's weak policies. Half-hearted attempts at an agreement with France were abandoned when the Italians could see no advantage to themselves. Many of the leading figures in the foreign policy establishment were four square behind an Italian bid for another African colony. In April 1930, Dino Grandi, Minister of Foreign Affairs, told the Fascist Grand Council that a strong Italy could not forever remain clinging to the extreme edge of the Eritrean Altopiano Highland Plateau and stuck in the restricted space of Italian Somalia. The nation had a civilizing mission in the Black Continent to carry out, and the current generation had a problem to resolve, the colonial problem. At the Foreign Ministry, Raffaele Guariglia believed it was Italy's destiny to become a major African colonial power, as did Alessandro Lessona at the Colonial Ministry. As the history of colonization proved, nothing great is done in the world without getting blood on one's hands. A war would be easier for Italy now than it had been in the past. Abyssinia had lots of guns, though not of modern types. Her territories were well suited to defensive war, and her soldiers particularly adapted to fight it. But modern European military technology, and particularly aircraft, would give Italy the whip hand. The moment had come to consider this whole question, pregnant with dangers, but also with real possibilities for our country. However, Italy could not act alone. Given the current political and military situation, Guariglia believed that prior accords with France and Great Britain were indispensable. In 1932, Mussolini singled out Ethiopia, as the Italians liked to call it, as his next objective. As a first step, he sent his favourite general to scout the ground. Emilio de Bono returned with the news that the Negus, Emperor Haile Selassie, was consolidating his power and intended at some future time to take up arms against Italy. Italy must prepare for a preventive war in the future. For the moment, though, armed intervention was out of the question. In August, the army approached De Bono about naming a commander designate in order to begin planning. De Bono went straight to Mussolini, who immediately gave him the role. De Bono planned to conquer northern Abyssinia with 35,000 white troops, 50,000 Eritrean askari, 100 aircraft, and only a month's preparation. Now ensconced at Tripoli, where he was masterminding the brutal suppression of the local tribes, Badoglio was happy to see that this very important problem was finally being addressed. The army general staff was not. Its chief, General Alberto Bonzani, excoriated a rash plan that proposed to push two separate forces 80 kilometers forward onto the Alto Piano, fight the enemy when he was mobilized and had been allowed to close up to relatively close range, and then, after a successful battle, pursue him in depth. Having just expressed lively satisfaction with De Bono, Badoglio now put up a plan of his own. Stand on the defensive, wait until the enemy had assembled, strike with air power, and follow that up with a counteroffensive to liquidate him definitively. His suggestions for a designated commander were clearly designed to exclude De Bono. On the 1st of January 1934, Badoglio came back to Rome. Over the next 3 months, the top brass struggled for control over the shaping of Mussolini's first war. Badoglio thought that accords with London and Paris were the essential diplomatic foundation for action, otherwise at the least they might arm the Abyssinians. The army general staff too wanted the whole venture set in a broad scenario which took account of whether Italy was in alliance with France or at war with her. Mussolini wanted action in 1935. Either there would be peace in Europe during the next few years, in which case a defensive position could act as the base either for an offensive or a counteroffensive, or a worsening European situation would not allow Italy to deploy force in Africa, in which case a defensive organization, will allow us to break down any attempt by the Abyssinians. In late March, with the French now apparently favouring an accord, Mussolini announced that he had decided to finish off Abyssinia. Rather than put De Bono in complete charge, he accepted Badoglio's argument that it was the Army General Staff's responsibility to do the planning. A letter duly winged its way to De Bono. Its recipient exploded. That pig of a Badoglio had tried to do him down, and had succeeded. With no choice, De Bono gave way, though the actual conduct of the campaign still lay in his hands. The chiefs of staff met briefly at the Palazzo Venezia on the 7th of May 1934 to discuss force levels for the proposed operation. Immediately, Badoglio tried to apply the brakes, as he would do again in 1940. A war would cost 6 milliards and would put the army in crisis during the campaign and then afterwards as it struggled to refill its magazines and stores. And there would be a permanent burden of occupation. Was it worth it? When he was told that preparing for a campaign in Ethiopia would take 3 years, the Duce called Badoglio and De Bono to the Palazzo Venezia on the 31st of May and laid out the modus operandi for the next few months. Defensive arrangements must be made as quickly as possible, after which the problem of provoking the Abyssinians into action would be addressed. In the meantime, everything was to be done in the colony and internationally to avoid giving the game away. Juggling his multiple offices and his mistresses, the Duce forged ahead, leaving unresolved issues in his wake. How was De Bono's determination to take offensive action as soon as possible to be reconciled with Badoglio's to proceed slowly and cautiously? Whose budget was going to pay for it all? And could the country afford it? The General Staff estimated that a 6-month war in which 4 divisions took part would cost about 3 billion 500 million lire, and a year-long campaign would increase the bill to just short of 5 billion lire. The murder of the Austrian Chancellor, Engelbert Dollfuss, on the 25th of July 1934, left Mussolini unwilling for the moment to do anything that might weaken his military strength in Europe, but still ready to act. Defensive preparations in Eritrea must be accelerated. If the Abyssinians attacked, they were to be checked decisively, followed by a counteroffensive, in directions and with objectives that the situation at the time suggests. That autumn, 2 incidents ratcheted up the temperature. On the 4th of November, the Italian consulate in Gondar was attacked, and on the 22nd of November, there was an armed standoff between Abyssinians and Italians at the wells of Wal Wal, in an area where the frontier was not defined and where the Abyssinians contested the Italian occupation. Haile Selassie appealed to the League of Nations. The open challenge to Mussolini's prestige made him all the more determined to solve the Abyssinian problem with force before the tribes could benefit from an ongoing program of rearmament and training by European instructors. Time was working against Italy. The problem had to be resolved as soon as possible. That is, as soon as our military preparations give us the certainty of victory. There could only be one objective: the destruction of the Abyssinian forces and the total conquest of Ethiopia. Glancing over the international scene, Mussolini could see no likelihood of war in Europe during the coming 2 years. Accords with France, the consequent easing of relations with Yugoslavia, and the fact that Germany was as yet still too weak to contemplate attacking Austria, all gave him grounds for certainty. Everything and everyone must be on the spot and ready for October 1935. Until then, foreign policy must ensure that premature conflict was avoided. The Gordian knot of Italian-Abyssinian relations had to be cut before it was too late. The armed forces prepared to fight a war without quarter against a barbarous enemy. No false scruples were to be entertained, and no potential weapon was to be overlooked. Air power would be one of those weapons. Indeed, Mussolini intended Italian air power to play a leading role in the coming campaign. As well as destroying the only Abyssinian railway, he wanted troops, population, material resources, and all the bases of life bombed. The airmen welcomed his directives, which gave them operational and therefore strategic independence from the army, played to the publicity campaign waged by the air minister, Italo Balbo, and would allow them to try out General Douay's theories of terror bombing to which their leaders were oriented. The chief of the air staff, General Giuseppe Valle, obediently fell in line. In the closing months of 1935, the Air Force would wage a defensive war, halting and perhaps breaking any enemy offensive inclination and engendering in the enemy a salutary terror from which we can profit in 1936. Italian aircraft operating from bases along the Eritrean coast would sweep the entire zone of operations, carrying out whatever actions were required, including the destruction of Addis Ababa, of Gondar, of Harar, and the systematic burning of the entire Somalian highlands. Gas would play an integral part in the coming war. 10% of the munitions were to be gas bombs. The new year brought unwelcome news. Badoglio told Mussolini that the Air Force would not be ready to fight before October, and an expeditionary corps could not be in place on the Abyssinian Alto Piano until the following February. A rapid campaign needed foresight and meticulous preparation. Italy would need all of 1935 and the first 8 months of 1936 to be in a position to take on such an arduous task with the certainty of success. Valle concurred, fighting an offensive war would not be possible until the end of 1936 because of the lack of roads and infrastructure. Admiral Cavagnari, chief of the naval staff, warned that British and French agreement to action was essential, and League of Nations sanctions were very likely. Mussolini's response was to order his subordinates to press ahead quickly with war preparations. With Fascist Italy's prestige and his own increasingly in play, he was ready to fight if he had to, but also ready to garner his reward from the mere threat of aggression if that sufficed. Only if they, the League of Nations and especially Great Britain, see that we are ready to go to extreme lengths, he told Alessandro Lessona, will they perhaps be induced to allow the situation to resolve itself with honour and without war? On the diplomatic front, things looked promising. Pierre Laval, France's foreign minister, arrived in Rome at the beginning of January and concluded an accord with Italy containing a secret clause giving Mussolini a free hand in Abyssinia. Whether this included a rider excluding war, as Laval afterwards claimed, is still contested, but there were grounds enough for Mussolini to assume that the French were not likely to try to stop him. The Italian Foreign Ministry advised that Great Britain too was unlikely to put up serious opposition to a war against Ethiopia, and its Undersecretary Fulvio Suvich suggested that it would be possible to reach an understanding with her even after Italy had conquered Abyssinia. Italian soldiers and war materiel began transiting the Suez Canal, unmistakable signs that action was in the offing. Making a determined bid to take charge of the coming war, Badoglio put his war plan to Mussolini. Either the Abyssinians would attack en masse, in which case they would be beaten as long as best use was made by an able and energetic commander of Italy's superiority in both means and technical capacity, and could then be harried by Italian air power, or they would hold back, in which case the Italians could advance slowly in stages to Adigrat and Ardua, preceded by a violent air bombardment. Everything in the 700 kilometres between the frontier and Addis Ababa should be destroyed, and terror disseminated throughout the empire. The barely disguised move to push De Bono off his perch failed. On the 8th of March 1935, a day before Hermann Göring announced the creation of the Luftwaffe, and a week before Hitler announced that conscription would be revived in Germany, the Duce told De Bono he was sending not 2 but 10 divisions, along with 300 to 500 planes and 300 fast tanks. He was not going to make the same mistake as his predecessor, Francesco Crispi, had made in 1896, when, in a national humiliation, he had lost a campaign in Ethiopia for want of a few thousand men. Operations must start at the end of the coming September or in October. To men like Alessandro Lessona, the war that was about to start would be the completion of a colonial program begun 50 years before, when Italian soldiers first set foot on Arsub on the Red Sea coast, and would put Ethiopia's natural resources at Italy's disposal. To others, it was the first step in the planned progress to imperial grandeur, as indeed schoolchildren would be taught shortly after the war ended. Young Turks wanted war to liberate the regime from the stagnation into which it was sinking and remake a party that was no longer the guarantor of the original ideals of the fascist revolution. War was also welcomed as a mobilizing force that could reawaken the feelings of nationalism and patriotism which had flourished between 1915 and 1918, before being supposedly submerged beneath a red tide. On the 25th of May 1935, addressing the Italian Chamber of Deputies, Mussolini told them to look beyond the immediate issue of Austria and the defense of the Brenner Pass to the growing threat to Italian East Africa. No one should think of turning Abyssinia into a pistol perennially pointed at us. We have some old and some new scores to settle, he told the Sabaudar division in June on the eve of its departure for East Africa, and settle them we shall. At the end of July, in an article in Il Popolo d'Italia, his personal newspaper and the mouthpiece of the fascist party, he brushed aside slavery, race, and civilization as the basic causes of Italy's conflict with Ethiopia. There were only two essential, irrefutable matters at issue: the vital needs of the Italian people and the military security of East Africa. The latter was the decisive one. If Italy were to find itself committed in Europe, the threat that Ethiopia would pose would be strategically unsustainable, and until the looming military menace was eliminated, Eritrea and Somalia would never be safe. The solution could only be totalitarian. The Abyssinian threat was about to be eliminated, not by diplomacy, but by brute force. In June, Mussolini had written off Great Britain as likely to be bothersome only in the League of Nations. Then, at the start of August, came the news that the British Home Fleet was in fact being sent to the Mediterranean. Ordered to prepare plans for war with England, Badoglio summoned the chiefs of staff. Admiral Cavagnari and General Valle were unequivocal. Neither the Navy nor the Air Force was in any condition to fight England. At the time, contemporaries generally used the term England rather than Britain or Great Britain. Only the army was ready to take her on, and its contribution could not save the Mediterranean from falling under British dominance. Badoglio warned Mussolini, a war with England would face Italy with a situation that would be, by a long way, the gravest that our country has traversed throughout the eventful story of her formation and her national consolidation. Next day brought better news from London. Grandi, now the ambassador to England, told the Duce that the Admiralty had advised that war with Italy should be avoided, as the military efficiency of the Mediterranean fleet was not such as to guarantee success against the Italian Navy and Air Force. On the 21st of August, Mussolini ordered De Bono to be ready to start the war at any time after the 10th of September. De Bono asked for a further 8 to 10 days' grace and got it. With this, Badoglio came into line, assuring Mussolini that with 6 metropolitan divisions, as well as 2 native divisions and another 8 battalions to hand, De Bono could begin operations. An immense logistical effort put the resources in place for the war Mussolini demanded. The Navy built a railway, reservoirs and wharves at the port of Massawa on the Red Sea, increasing its unloading capacity from 400 to 500 tons a day to 2,000 and then finally 4,000 tons a day. Spending 950 million lire on hiring ships and paying Suez Canal duties, the Navy carried 595,204 men, 634,900 tons of supplies, 10,084 vehicles, and 40,859 animals to Eritrea and Somalia between February 1935 and July 1936. In the months before the war began, it shipped in enough materials for the Air Force to build 6 main bases, 18 airports, and 84 field landing strips, as well as bringing in 49,500 tons of fuel and lubricants and 14,500 tons of munitions. A surge of effort by all the military agencies produced a vast panoply of essential war goods, from refrigerator ships and hospital ships at one end of the spectrum to maps and khaki uniforms at the other. The prospect of a war in Abyssinia galvanized the officer corps. 4,000 active officers and 17,000 reserve officers put in requests to serve, some using the normal route of the War Office, others going via the royal household or members of the government. The fascist propaganda machine went full blast, churning out simple messages about national pride and the need to escape from the position imposed on Italy by the egoism and fear of the rich nations. The Catholic Church joined the cause. Although the Pope remained studiously neutral, the hierarchy and the rank and file fell in behind Mussolini. 3 weeks after the war began, Cardinal Schuster told the congregation assembled in the Duomo in Milan that their army was spilling its blood, to open the doors of Ethiopia to the Catholic faith and to Roman civilization. The Bishop of Terracina assured Mussolini that the hearts of all Italians were beating in unison with his, and the Bishop of Ozieri told his flock that the war was neither a colonial nor a political issue, but a moral and religious one, in which Protestantism, Freemasonry, Communism, and anti-fascism were trying to destroy the civilization of Rome because it was Catholic. At 5 a.m. on the morning of the 3rd of October 1935, 4 Italian and 2 Eritrean divisions, 110,000 men in all, crossed the frontier and marched into Abyssinia. At De Bono's direction, a 3-pronged advance drove the 50 or so kilometers to Ardigrat and Ardua. At first, there was little resistance. What the Italians did not know was that the local chieftain had been ordered by Haile Selassie to avoid battle and stick to guerrilla action. The Italians were in Ardigrat in 2 days and Ardua in 3. With Dino Grandi in London warning of the danger that an incident with British forces in the Mediterranean or the Red Sea might expand the conflict, and his Undersecretary Suvich pressing for a further advance, Mussolini decided to send Badoglio and Lessona to Eritrea to see what could be done there if the conflict did balloon. For the moment, though, France was evidently in the mood for conciliation, and London denied any intention of preparing for war. A telegram was dispatched from Palazzo Venezia ordering De Bono to push on quickly to Marcale. Like many of the objectives in the first phase of the war, it had great historical significance for the Italians. In January 1896, only weeks before the disaster at Ardua in which he was killed, Major Galliano and a force of 1,350 soldiers had held out under siege there for 9 days before being granted a safe conduct by Menelik II. De Bono dug in his heels and refused to move before the 10th of November. With a British election due very shortly and the possibility that sanctions, voted by the League of Nations on the 19th of October and currently not including oil, would be tightened, Mussolini needed action. De Bono was instructed to begin the next stage of the advance on the 3rd of November. When all the territories lost in 1896 were back in Italian hands, Mussolini declared he intended to suspend hostilities. The pressure on him at that moment was as much financial as international. Imports were set to rise considerably, exports were likely to be down by half in the coming year, and gold was flowing out of the Banca d'Italia. Instructions came down from on high that military orders were to be kept rigorously within the bounds of previously agreed imports of raw materials, and war materials only to be acquired from countries that were not imposing sanctions. Badoglio's report landed on Mussolini's desk early in November. De Bono was tired to the point of complete exhaustion. He was 69, 5 years older than Badoglio. The high command in Eritrea was static in spirit and in function, and the chief staff officers were being run on a loose rein. What the whole force lacked was the guidance of a commander with prestige and authority. Reluctantly, De Bono recommenced his attack. Once again, there was little enemy resistance, but advance was difficult. The rains had degraded the mule tracks so that it took several days for the guns and light tanks to catch up with the foot soldiers ahead of them. De Bono's men reached Marcale on the 8th of November. Again, Mussolini urged his hesitant commander forward, telling him to push his Eritrean troops out to Ambar Alagi. It too carried huge symbolic significance. On the 7th of December 1895, it had been the scene of a hopeless battle in which 2,350 Italian troops, mostly Askari, had been overwhelmed by 30,000 Ethiopians. This was a war in which deep wounds could at last be avenged. De Bono protested. He was at the end of a 500-kilometer supply line. His artillery had not yet come up. His reserves were strung out along the road network, and his defences were far from complete. Mussolini had had enough. On the 14th of November, De Bono was relieved. His reward for a job rather less than half done, the baton of a Maresciallo d'Italia, and Badoglio took over the war. Badoglio left Naples on the 18th of November 1935. And by the end of the month, he was at Asmara on the Alto Piano. Waiting for him was intelligence suggesting that 150,000 Ethiopians were on the march. As far as he was concerned, the aim of the war was the total destruction of the Abyssinian armed forces and the complete conquest of Ethiopia. But first, things must be properly organized so that we are not up in the air as we are now. Then, and only then, active military operations could and would follow. While Mussolini waited to see whether Geneva would apply petrol sanctions, Badoglio set about methodically establishing a secure defence. In the febrile world of fascist military politics, Badoglio's appointment challenged the status of a new generation. The chief of the Army General Staff, General Federico Bistrocchi, busy disseminating his own ideas for a new kind of guerra lampo, fast war, thought Badoglio lacked the necessary fascist dash and genius, and feared that he would conduct operations at a slow and steady pace, with heavy forces anchored to the terrain. What were needed were light, agile columns that could move quickly to take advantage of surprise. He urged Mussolini to recall the chief of the armed forces general staff to Rome, where he belonged, and to take personal command, aided by a technical expert with a broad viewpoint, without preconceptions, a fascist devoted to you, in other words, himself. The men on the spot, Badoglio, General Rodolfo Graziani on the Somalian front, and Italo Balbo, now governor of Libya, were, he claimed, each seeing the war from their own perspective. What was needed was centralized control, and only Mussolini could see the whole war in the round and issue orders which everyone will obey. Orbiting above the squabbling, Mussolini was prepared to give his new field commander time, as long as he did not waste it. Reading the cultural mindset of his opponent with some accuracy, Badoglio thought that a battle could develop spontaneously on one or more sectors of his front, regardless of the emperor's intentions, as a result of the independence and rivalry of the Ethiopian Rus. The immediate threat was an attack on the nodal point of his line at Markale by up to 200,000 Ethiopians. After a quick tour of the line, he explained to his corps commanders why nothing was happening just now. The first priority was organizing a defensive line that would allow secure and continuous replenishment for the troops gathered in the Markale area. So, for some time, they would be standing still, but offensive operations would then follow. Badoglio had good reason to be cautious, for De Bono had left him in a precarious strategic situation. His forces were split into two separate parts, one around Ardua and the other at Markale. Although they were only 100 kilometers apart, there were no direct communications between them. The troops at Ardua had to be supplied along two mule tracks that could be cut by the Ethiopians, and both flanks of the Markale position were wide open as far back as the frontier with Eritrea, 170 kilometers away. With threats developing to Ardua and Aksum on his right and to Markale on his left, Badoglio made his only mistake of the campaign, leaving the central stretch of his line at Tembien, guarded by four blackshirt divisions. The result was a minor but annoying setback when the blackshirts retreated in the face of an Ethiopian attack, potentially opening up a route through the Italian positions. Badoglio swiftly moved his Eritreans into the line, countering the threat. On the right, Ras Imiru and 30,000 to 40,000 Ethiopians pushed back General Maravinia's forward defences at Dembeguina, forcing the Eritrean troops who were holding the pass to withdraw at a cost of 401 casualties. On the 15th of December, a small detachment of eight light tanks with no infantry support allowed itself to be drawn into combat with Ethiopians advancing on the Dembeguina Pass. Two tanks were destroyed, two crewmen decapitated, and the other two carried off to meet an unknown fate. The remaining six tanks withdrew across rough ground, and were eventually brought to a standstill when the Ethiopians disabled their tracks and guns. Italian machine guns, it emerged, could simply be bent, and knocked out their radiators with hand grenades. All eight tanks were destroyed or abandoned, and only four Italians, two of whom were wounded, got out of the imbroglio. Mussolini was put out at the setback, which created a very poor impression. Badoglio reassured him, such minor annoyances were no real threat to the situation and might even be beneficial. Sad events like this were needed to convince officers and men that we are actually in enemy territory. The Air Force had been unable to prevent the assembling of the Ethiopian forces. After the first bombing, they dispersed and moved up out of sight of the watching aircraft. So, to protect the slow advance of his own troops, Badoglio ordered the Air Force to use all means available to slow down the advance of the enemy columns. On the 23rd of December 1935, the Regia Aeronautica dropped six gas bombs, the first of the campaign, on Ethiopian troops. 5 days later, Mussolini formally authorized Badoglio to use both gas and flamethrowers. In February 1936, he would propose using bacteriological warfare, which Badoglio refused to do. The Italians quickly learned that aerial war had to be used with at least some circumspection. The news that Italian aircraft had bombed a Swedish Red Cross hospital threatened to turn international opinion further against Italy. Immediately, fresh instructions went out from Rome. The bombing of Abyssinian cities, including Addis Ababa, was suspended, and so was attacking, or even overflying, communications between Abyssinia and the outside world. "No one is more in favor of harsh war than I am," Mussolini told Badoglio, "but the necessary reprisals must be intelligent." Unsure whether the Ethiopians were going to operate in accordance with some overarching strategic plan formulated by the emperor, or fight a series of local actions, and with a 250-kilometer front to defend, Badoglio needed more men. He asked for 2 more divisions, and Mussolini sent him 3, urging him to get on and win the war as soon as he could. After making sure that his supply lines were secure and fully functional, Badoglio was ready to move. In front of him were 3 separate Ethiopian armies. On his right, facing Ardawa, stood Ras Imiru with 40,000 men. In the center, Ras Kasa and Ras Sejum with 30,000 men. And on his left, facing Markale, Ras Mulugeta with 80,000 men. Mussolini urged Badoglio forward. The parola d'ordine was not to wait passively for the enemy to take the initiative, but to defeat him. In battles which will be large or small according to circumstance, but victorious. Badoglio hoped to launch his main offensive south from Markale to Ambar Aradam soon. He was also aware of the possibility that his right wing at Ardawa Aksum might be attacked. In the event, his first battle was fought not on the right or left of his line, but in the middle. To secure his center and to preempt an offensive by his opponent, Badoglio decided to adopt a plan proposed by General Pierzio Biroli and attack Ras Kasa. The first battle of Tembien, fought by Pierzio Biroli's Eritrean Corps, ended with Ras Kasa's withdrawal, but all was not plain sailing. At one point, when a blackshirt division had lost 450 dead and wounded, Badoglio ordered his staff to begin work in strictest secrecy on a plan for a complete withdrawal from Markale, but was persuaded by subordinates to suspend it. However, the crisis soon passed, and on the 24th of January, Badoglio informed Rome that the enemy had fallen back. Tembien was an important battle. Tactically, neither side had won an outright victory, but strategically the Italian position was now secure. The Air Force had demonstrated the importance of air intervention and the role it could fulfill, not only, according to its commander, Agmone Cart, contributing to the resolution of the tactical situation, as in all other phases of the campaign, but reversing it. Throughout the rest of the campaign, air power would play a crucial role, hammering retreating enemy columns, sealing off rear areas with gas, and protecting and resupplying the columns that would soon advance on Gondar, Lake Tana, and Addis Ababa. During the battle, Badoglio had been able to take advantage of intercepted Ethiopian radio messages. These would become an increasingly valuable ace in his hand as the war went on. Rome provided more intelligence from intercepted messages from the Abyssinian delegation at Geneva. Perhaps most importantly, Tembien enabled Badoglio to test the effectiveness of European training and modern weapons on Ethiopian fighting power, and also gauge how far the Negus was able to coordinate and control his factious tribal chiefs. The encouraging conclusion was that the military progress Abyssinia had appeared to be making with European help before the war was purely superficial. The Ethiopians did indeed have better weapons than before, and their warlike spirit was high, but the Negus had clearly not been able to impose a modern organization on his tribal levies or exert a coordinating authority over them. The intercepts told Badoglio that Haile Selassie did not know what to do next, and was far from sure of the loyalty of the Ras. While Badoglio was preparing and fighting his battle in the north, General Rodolfo Graziani pulled off a dramatic success in the south. After fending off an Ethiopian attack on the 12th of January, he launched a column of 7,000 men into the southern Abyssinian province of Sidamo, taking Negeli and forcing Haile Selassie to switch troops to the south. Addis Ababa was now only 365 miles away along a motor road, but instead of pushing on into the heart of enemy territory, Graziani obeyed instructions from Mussolini and sent columns out west to the border with Kenya, penetrating 130 kilometers into enemy territory. In March, the annual rains arrived, and movement in the south came to a halt. Tembien had cost the Abyssinians some 5,000 casualties, but they still had 150,000 men in the field and another 25,000 to 30,000 on their way. With his supply services ready at last to back up a large-scale advance, Badoglio laid his plans for a great offensive which would break Ethiopian resistance. Collecting together a force of 40 battalions, 40,000 to 50,000 men, and 230 guns, he would press forward from Markale on the left end of his line against Ras Mulugeta and his 80,000 Abyssinians. This was the largest of the three Ethiopian armies, and its focal point, the well-defended mountain of Ambar Aradam, commanded all the main communications in its vicinity. Mulugeta would either have to fight, in which case Badoglio was confident of winning, or withdraw and expose the lines of communication running to the two other Abyssinian forces facing the Italians' centre and right. Either outcome would then offer him the opportunity to defeat the other two armies in detail. Tactically, Badoglio was playing to Italian strengths and Abyssinian weaknesses. His advancing troops would rely heavily on artillery and air power, defending their flanks with strong defensive positions and drawing out the fight in order to wear down Abyssinian nerves and use up the enemy's limited supplies of ammunition before turning his flanks and then smashing his center. The plan was submitted to Mussolini, who approved it. At dawn on the 11th of February 1936, the Italian artillery opened up on the Ethiopians, firing shells charged with arsine. Gas shells were used again next day, and on the day the battle took place. In all, 22,908 rounds were fired during the battle, of which 1,367 were gas shells. Though gas-charged rounds continued to arrive in Eritrea, they would not be used again, probably because they seemingly had little effect in mountainous terrain. After advancing in alternate bounds for 3 days, the two army corps that would fight the battle paused for 2 days to reposition their artillery and improve communications. A lone Ethiopian chief, Makonnen Demisier, understanding that the Italians were going to encircle Mulugeta's forces, tried to surround one of the advancing infantry regiments, but was fought off. Badoglio was sublimely confident. "We shall win the war with a lightning campaign, the like of which has not been seen since Napoleon's day," he told a group of embedded journalists on the eve of the battle. The war would be won, and the Ethiopian Empire would collapse under Italian blows in little more than 2 months, he assured them. The Battle of Endeta, which took place on the 15th of February, was the largest engagement of the war. At dawn, the battlefield was swathed in a dense fog, hindering Italian observation from the air and limiting the effectiveness of the guns. But as the sun rose, it dissolved, and at about 9 in the morning, the fighting began. Two pincers drove into the Abyssinian mass from the flanks, while a smaller column fixed them in the center. The Ethiopians launched three fierce counterattacks during the morning and early afternoon, but the Italian guns broke them all. Artillery played a big part in the Italian victory. In the course of the day, 280 guns fired 23,000 rounds. So too did air power. The Regia Aeronautica carrying out 44 missions on the day and dropping 13,388 kilos of explosives. Afterwards, Agmone Cart claimed that air action during the battle had reduced Italian casualties from an estimated 3,000 to only 300. At noon, Mulu Geta left the field of battle, and 3 hours later, air reconnaissance reported that the Ethiopians were retiring. A battalion of the 23 Marzo Blackshirt Division was allowed the credit of taking the summit of Ambar Aradam, though the Alpini had done the lion's share of the fighting and probably got there first. Although at the end of the day he had won a victory, again Badoglio's battle did not go entirely as he intended. The two Italian wings had failed to join up, leaving a gap 3 kilometers wide through which Mulu Geta was able to slip away. Only a handful of tribesmen managed to flee with him. The Ethiopians lost some 20,000 men on the field of battle and more in the retreat that followed. Gala tribesmen joined in against their traditional enemies, and the Air Force played its part. The 16th of February saw the heaviest day's bombing in the entire war. Gas dropped from the air on the retreating Ethiopians added to the slaughter. Italian losses numbered 134 dead and 523 wounded in the white units, and 63 dead and 83 wounded in the native units. Mulu Geta himself was killed during the retreat. The enemy was now in disarray, as Badoglio knew from intercepts. Haile Selassie wanted the remaining two tribal armies to pull back towards Ambar Alaji to form a single compact force, but lacked the authority to enforce his wishes. Ras Emiru on the Ethiopian left was standing on the defensive, and Ras Kasa in the center, now worried about what might have happened to Mulu Geta's men on his own right flank, intended to move to his left to join Emiru. Daily intercepts told the Italians much about the confusion and lack of coordination in the enemy's camp. The Abyssinians were now wide open to defeat in detail. Along the Italian front, 5 army corps began to move. In the fighting to come, Badoglio shaped Italian combat methods to negate the enemy's strengths. Rapidity and fluidity of movement, lightning attacks, and a complete disregard of casualties. Italian forces, accompanied by lots of guns and machine guns and copious supplies of ammunition, would advance leapfrog style in bounds so that the elements on the move were always supported by those that had momentarily halted. Following Mulu Geta's retreating tribesmen, the 3 divisions of General Santini's 1st Corps pushed south to Ambar Alaji, meeting no real resistance. And on the 28th of February, the Italian tricolore flew again over the fort, where, in December 1895, Major Pietro Tozzelli and 3/5 of his garrison of 2,350 men had perished after trying to fight off 30,000 Ethiopians. Meanwhile, General Pirzio Biroli's Eritrean Corps went after Ras Kasa. To reach their target, his men had to cross a range of rocky peaks dotted with patches of vegetation and broken by innumerable caverns, which offered shelter for occasionally stiff resistance. Once again, Italian logistics worked a minor miracle, bringing forward 48,000 rounds of artillery ammunition and 7 million rounds of small arms ammunition along rough tracks where trucks sank up to their axle hubs in sand. The Eritreans smashed Kasa's men in the Second Battle of Tembien before joining up with General Ettore Bastico's 3rd Corps and cutting off their retreat. Italian aircraft again played an important role in the battle, dropping 100 tons of explosives and harassing the retreating Ethiopians with thousands of incendiaries. Gas bombs were used to make fords impassable to retreating Ethiopians. The battle cost the Abyssinians 8,000 men, the Italians 393 dead and wounded, and the Eritreans 188. It was now Ras Emiru's turn to experience the fascist war machine. Again, the Battle of Shire did not go quite according to plan. According to the original battle plan, Maravigna's 2nd Corps advancing from the east and Barbini's 4th Corps coming from the north would converge from opposite directions and crush the enemy in a concentric maneuver. Maravigna's troops had only 30 kilometers to cover through easy country, part hills and part plain, and crossed by a motor road, but they faced determined resistance which slowed them down by a day. Barbini's men, on the other hand, faced a 90-kilometer march across very broken ground, covered with thick, spiny vegetation, and entirely without water, in territory that was completely unknown. Since the plan offered Emiru the opportunity to strike each of the two Italian corps in turn, Badoglio changed it. Now the 2nd Corps would attack the enemy head-on, while the 4th Corps threatened his flank and rear. Maravigna's troops began moving in the early hours of the 29th of February, but were slowed down when the advance guard of one of his divisions ran into some stiff resistance. Next day, he had to ask for 24 hours' pause to reorganize his forces and restock with more munitions. Whether or not Badoglio was responsible for the delay, as Maravigna claimed years later, it was certainly true that timing the movement of the two corps had not been managed as well as it could have been. Maravigna's men resumed their march on the 2nd of March and were again slowed down by the enemy. Neither newly arrived flamethrowers nor tanks which continually shed their tracks proved of much assistance. Aware of the threat that was developing, Emiru took advantage of the two-day pause in the 2nd Corps' advance to break off the engagement and retreat. The 4th Corps marched undisturbed to its designated target ground, making no contribution to the battle. Emiru left 4,000 dead on the field and lost another 3,000 men to Italian air attacks during withdrawal, gas again playing its part. Totally demoralized, his remaining force dissolved, and Emiru himself fled towards Gondar with a few hundred men. The last Ethiopian army left on the northern front had been neutralized, at a cost of 868 Italian and Eritrean dead and wounded. The success of the Tigray operations owed a great deal to skill and effectiveness with which the Italian intendenza had managed the logistics. 5 army corps had been kept supplied in mountainous regions lacking any resources, more than 400 kilometers from the coast and 4,000 kilometers from the Italian patria. Over 900 trucks had transported weapons and munitions, and 2 army corps, the 3rd and the 4th, had been partially resupplied by air. An entire division had been moved from the coast to the front at Markale in only 38 hours, using 650 vehicles. In the first 2 weeks of February alone, the supply services carried 200,000 rounds of artillery ammunition, 22 million rounds of small arms ammunition, and tens of thousands of grenades to frontline units, as well as dozens of cannon and hundreds of rifles and sidearms. Every day, the trucks, 6,000 camels and 4,000 mules, sent forward 5,000 kilos of flour, 400 kilos of frozen meat, 150,000 cartons of milk, 4,000 hectolitres of wine, 900 kilos of jam, 450 kilos of dried fruit, 1,200 kilos of biscuit, 15,000 kilos of tobacco, 150,000 bottles of mineral water, and 500,000 cans of meat and soup. Every division had 2 field hospitals, Every corps had a surgical centre, and 3 central field hospitals were set up with 1,800 beds. Thanks to intercepts, Badoglio knew that Emiru had only a handful of men left, that only Haile Selassie's Imperial Guard, together with a handful of irregulars and the few survivors of the earlier battles, amounting to between 30,000 and 50,000 men, now stood between him and outright victory in the field, and that at an Imperial Council of War on the 26th of March, a reluctant emperor had sided with the aggressive majority and now intended to advance against him. In what would turn out to be the last act of the war, the Ethiopians were playing straight into the Italians' hands. Having forsworn guerrilla war at the outset as being beneath their warrior mentality, they should now have drawn Badoglio deeper into the country and away from his supply bases, as he feared they might do. Instead, they allowed themselves to become victims as much of their own traditions as of Italian material and organizational superiority. Knowing that he was facing 31,000 Ethiopians, and that the Negus intended to try to break into the fortified lines he had set up to secure the occupied territories, Badoglio laid out the timetable with which he intended to finish the war. The Negus would be beaten at the beginning of April. He would enter Addis Ababa as its conqueror on the 30th of April, and 10 days later he would leave the country and return to Italy. "I am only here to make war," he told Colonel Quirino Armellini. Staying in Abyssinia would mean taking on the complex and unrewarding task of building a new colonial administration there. It would also keep him away from Rome, and thereby expose him to the consequences of the political infighting that was part and parcel of life at the top of the fascist regime. Returning in triumph to the capital of Mussolini's new Roman Empire, on the other hand, would give him an undeniable claim to the rewards that the Duce was ready to dish out to those in favour, or those he did not wish to antagonise. Badoglio tightened the vice on the remaining Ethiopian resistance. A motorized column led by the fascist boss Achilles Darache set out on the 15th of March from Asmara, and after crossing more than 300 kilometers of unknown terrain, initially desert and then high mountain passes, without meeting any resistance, it reached Gondar, formerly the capital of Ethiopia, on the 1st of April, at the same time as an Eritrean column. The native troops were held back to give the fascist the laurels. By the end of the month, Lake Tana and the entire region were in Italian hands. The First Corps pushed steadily south towards Lake Ashenge, building a road as it went, while Italian aircraft dropped gas bombs on concentrations of Ethiopian troops ahead of it. Then came what was to Badoglio welcome news. Rather than retreat back to Dessier, the Negus proposed to fight. Taking his time, Badoglio paused for 2 weeks to finish building the roads and bring up the troops and munitions he needed for what he told Mussolini would be a grandiose action that could be truly decisive. He planned to complete the concentration of his forces on the 31st of March and start his advance on Dessier the next day. Then, unexpectedly, the Ethiopians began to advance. Armed only with picks and shovels, the Italians hastily threw up a makeshift defensive line consisting mostly of dry stone walls and branches of trees, and defended only by light-caliber guns, and awaited the enemy. 3 Italian frontline divisions, some 40,000 men, faced about the same number of Ethiopians. The Battle of Maichu began at 5:45 a.m. on the 31st of March 1936, with a head-on attack by Ethiopians on General Luigi Negri's Pusteria division. The troops held their ground in the face of what seemed like a human flood, as wave after wave threw themselves against the defences and were cut down by bursts of rifle and machine gun fire. Then the Ethiopians shifted their attack to the east of Negri's position, aiming for the Makan Pass defended by the 2nd Eritrean Division, hoping that resistance there would be less determined and that they could open up a gap in the centre of the Italian line. Shortly after 8 in the morning, the Regia Aeronautica joined in the fray. 70 Italian bombers, one of them piloted by Mussolini's son Bruno, began bombing the battlefield, the Ethiopians' rear, and their supply lines. The Negus threw in his Imperial Guard, and for 3 hours a fierce fight raged for control of the pass. A counterattack with the bayonet led by the divisional commander, General Renzo Dalmazzo, gradually ran out of steam as the Askari paused to loot the battlefield and was forced back to its starting line. Throughout the afternoon, attack was met by counterattack. At about 4 p.m., three columns of fresh Ethiopian troops attacked both wings of Negri's line. Bitter fighting went on for 2 hours, and then, as twilight began to fall, Haile Selassie ordered his forces to withdraw. The battle had lasted more than 14 hours. The Italians lost 89 dead and 291 wounded, their Eritrean Askari 204 dead and 669 wounded. Ethiopian losses are unknown, but probably amounted to between 5,000 and 8,000. The Emperor, in a telegram to his Empress that night, which, like so many others, was intercepted and deciphered, praised his troops' determination, but admitted that they were unable to carry out European-style combat. The attack was renewed the next day, but although Italian aircraft were hampered by bad weather, three more Italian divisions came into line. Demoralized by their failure, the losses suffered in battle, and the desertions that were now accruing, the Ethiopians began to retreat. With that, the weather cleared, enabling the Italian Air Force to strike them at will. With only 5,000 tribesmen blocking Badoglio's route to the capital, where the Emperor's Imperial Guard faced the likelihood of being surrounded, the Ethiopian Foreign Minister, in yet another intercepted telegram, warned that the military situation was becoming unsustainable. The Italians were halfway to Dessier, and there was no army to stop them. Pirzio Biroli's Eritreans pursued the fleeing Ethiopians, who moved at night to escape the watching eyes of Italian aircraft. Advancing more than 250 kilometers in a week, thanks to a well-organized aerial resupply service, they reached Dessier, an important crossroads for caravan routes, which was also the Ethiopians' strongest strategic bulwark, on the 15th of April. At the same time, Graziani was ordered to attack from the south. While Mussolini sprayed out ambiguous telegrams from Rome suggesting that he was willing to treat with Haile Selassie, the war in Ethiopia moved inexorably towards its end. As Badoglio prepared to strike the last blow, Graziani, who had spent most of February and March intriguing with Bistrocchi in Rome to get control of the army and the colonial forces after the war, launched his attack on Harar. Graziani's 38,000 troops faced some 30,000 Ethiopians spread out in depth in front of him. He planned a lightning advance into enemy territory by three columns. His intention was to fight a different kind of campaign from the one Badoglio was masterminding. A more elastic tactical organization freed from supply bases was designed to contrast sharply with the ponderous war machine that was grinding its way down to Addis Ababa in the north. Graziani's attack on the Ogaden, spearheaded by colonial troops, began on the 15th of April. After overcoming some determined resistance, he fought a major battle on the 24th to the 25th of April, losing 2,000 dead and wounded, and then paused to reorganize and resupply his men. Anxious to get his venture over as quickly as possible, Mussolini promised Graziani the baton of a Marshal of Italy if and when he conquered Harar. It took the Italian engineers and supply services 10 days to create a viable line of communications from Maichu to Dessier and bring up the stores and munitions needed for the final push. On the 24th of April 1936, the assault on the capital began. 20,000 Italian and Eritrean troops, supported by 1,725 lorries and trucks, advanced on Addis Ababa along the two main routes to the capital. So did 12 generals, the Undersecretary of the Colonial Ministry, Alessandro Lessona, the fascist hierarch, Giuseppe Bottai, 2 senators, a prince, 21 journalists, Badoglio's 2 sons, and his nephew. A motorized column under General Garibaldi and a separate group of 4 battalions of Eritreans on foot went down one route, while another column at brigade strength marched down the other. The 2 marching columns started first, ready to deal with any substantial Ethiopian resistance, but there was none worth the name. Once this was apparent, the main motorized column leapfrogged ahead of its supports. By the evening of the 4th of May, the capital was in sight. The Eritrean column had already been encamped within sight of Addis Ababa for 2 days, but the honor of taking the capital had to go to white troops. At 4 p.m. on Tuesday, the 5th of May, a victorious Badoglio led his soldiers into the capital, not on horseback as he would have liked, but in a motor car because of the rain. Haile Selassie had already gone. Advised by the French minister resident not to put the 6,000 foreign residents of Addis Ababa at risk by trying to defend it, he left 3 days before the Italians arrived, boarding the British cruiser Enterprise at Djibouti on the 3rd of May and sailing to Haifa. 3 days later, in appalling weather, Graziani's troops entered Harar. The war was over. In all, some 18,000 officers and 477,000 troops took part in the conquest of Abyssinia, backed by 1,500 guns, 500 tanks and 450 aircraft, supported by 103,000 pack animals and 19,000 motor vehicles. Military casualties were relatively light. 2,988 white soldiers and 1,457 Askari died, and 7,815 white and 3,307 native soldiers were wounded. The official Ethiopian death toll numbered some 275,000. The Air Force, which flew 50,000 hours and dropped 1,800 tons of bombs, had 8 aircraft shot down by the Abyssinians, who had only a few modern early-con anti-aircraft guns, and lost 131 officers and men in air and ground combat and flying accidents. The cost was officially put at 12,111,000,000 lire. But to persuade both the populace and the outside world that fascist Italy could conquer an empire without upsetting the balance between income and expenditure, much of it was kept off balance sheet and deferred to subsequent years. Funding it took a third of Italy's gold and foreign currency reserves, and by 1940, the new East African Empire had cost 46 billion lire, or 21% of total state spending, paid for by debt, mostly in the shape of treasury bonds. In 6 months, the Italian armed forces had conquered a country bigger than France and Germany put together, much to the surprise of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.